Welcome to the Classical Gabfest, a weekly discussion about the ever-changing world of classical music. I'm your host for this week, William White, and with me as always are Tiffany Liu and Kensho Watanabe. This week we'll be discussing a new children's book by the composer Lara Auerbach. Then we'll have an episode of our Concert Club featuring the Frankfurt Radio Symphony. And finally, we will talk about criticism and counter-criticism of the Chamber Music Society of Lincoln Center playing out in the pages of the New York Times. But first, we'd like to start with our prelude segment. So, Kensho, what do we have today?
This week, we'll be playing a round of everyone's favorite game, Match the Interpreter. If you search online for a Beethoven or Mozart symphony, you'll come up with literally hundreds of different performances, and in the world of classical music, we like to think that every individual artist brings their own personal spin to the interpretation of works such as these. But the question is, just how audible are those interpretive fingerprints? In this game, I'm going to play the same excerpt as performed by three different interpreters, and it's going to be up to our contestants to see if they can match those clips to the three interpreters listed. This week, the focus is on conductors, and we've got three: Valery Gergiev, George Schulte, and Bernard Haitink. And I think in this discussion as well, I should probably tell you what excerpts I'm going to play, because that also, I think, might pique your interest. So I'm going to play the very end of Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony. So with that in mind, what sorts of musical associations do you have with these three conductors, and what are your thoughts about the end of that symphony?
Well, I mean, if we just start with the conductors, I can say a few things about them. I mean, Valery Gergiev, sort of an untamed brute. You never know what you're going to get. Very chaotic, kind of a wild man on the podium. Inconsistent in terms of his interpretive qualities. I would say that Bernard Haitink is the diametric opposite of that. Very calm, cool, and collected. Very consistent. Breathes a certain kind of spiritual quality into his interpretations, which can really take off sometimes, sometimes falls into the realms of boredom. And then Schulte, I think of as being a very exciting, precise, consistent conductor, really goes after the main juice in any piece that he's doing. Sort of angular and very rhythmic are the qualities that I would give to him. Tiff, what do you think? Or maybe do you want to comment on the controversial ending of Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony?
Well, what Will is alluding to is the quality of whether a conductor decides to view the ending as the triumphant glory to the Soviet state that I guess Shostakovich made his money off of and bet on it being interpreted as in the time he wrote it, or the scream of anguish that it has since come to imply kind of that it's under that underpins that long A at the end. And I don't know about, I guess I could make a guess at what these conductors think about that, but more than that, I think it might be instructive to think about what orchestras these people generally recorded with, because the main body of Schulte's work, I'm going to say, is probably with Chicago. And during a certain era of Chicago playing, you know, really balls to the wall, kind of big brass, really bright sound, I think, sometimes a little stringent. And then by contrast, Haitink did a lot of recordings with Concertgebouw, and probably more in the modern era, I would suspect. And since recording characteristics tends to be part of our analysis in this game, it might be instructive to think about that as well.
Yeah, and Gergiev, you know, recording largely with the Mariinsky Theater Orchestra.
Sure.
But, you know, but they've all recorded. I mean, like, I would say that Kensho could probably find a Shostakovich 5 with the Vienna Philharmonic with all three of these people. You know, I mean, they get around. But Tiffany, I like your strategy. I think that's a very good
I'm
one.
I'm really bad at this game. And I find conducting fingerprints obviously the hardest, right, in this game to interpret. Because, like, depending on which orchestra, the same conductor could release vastly different recordings. And it's the same conductor. So to the question that is posed in the introduction for this game of do these interpretive fingerprints really matter? It's like, okay, well, only insofar as the orchestra will let it matter.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I, like you, don't know where any of these conductors stand on the question of how to interpret the finale of Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony, which is largely a question of tempo. I mean, you know, some people take it literally twice as slow as others. So,
yeah. Well, get ready to hear a lot of A's.
Yeah.
Exactly. All right. Here is interpreter number one. And here is interpreter number two. And here is interpreter number three. What do you guys think?
You know, I think that maybe the game that we should play, like if we were smarter, would be match the engineer, you know?
Yeah, like, because there's such different priorities in these recordings, right? Mm-hmm. Not that any of us know.
Yeah, exactly.
Could you name one engineer?
No. Okay, so I thought that the first one was probably Gergiev. This was sort of a middle-of-the-road tempo, a triumphant sound. And I used Tiffany's tip. I found myself thinking along Tiffany's line quite a bit in terms of like the sounds of the orchestras mm-hmm. in listening to this. And I would say that in each of these, we heard the brass struggling, as we always do at the end of this piece. But I thought that they struggled, especially in the first excerpt. And that made me think that it's probably the Mariinsky Theater Orchestra.
We throw so much shade on this orchestra.
I know. The A's were very short and clipped. That's not something that you hear that much. You know, usually you hear them more legato. And they were very string forward. So that's sort of where I ended up on that one. Two and three, I don't know. Three was interesting because the percussion was so much more forward the entire time. And you could hear the piano on the A's,
yes.
which you couldn't in either of the other ones, as far as I was concerned. I was leaning towards saying that one was Schulte, but Number two could have been Schulte as well. I don't know. That was the slow one. Tiffany, what did you think?
I don't know that I'm on the same page as you for most of this, Will, even though I think we were thinking on the same lines. So, like, the order intuitively, and I would be okay with switching one and three, but my instinctive order was Schulte, Haitink, and then Gergiev.
Mm.
And I don't know whether I was just sort of, you know, reinforcing my own expectations of these orchestras and these people, but what I heard was that in the first recording, the brass... So while the Chicago brass have this, like, great reputation, I find that in some of Schulte's recordings that they're piercing in a way that's, like, not necessarily the most flattering, but it shows that they have chops.
Mm-hmm.
And that was what I heard in that, that kind of blazing quality. Again, that, like you said, that could be an engineering thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it also tracks with me that the recording engineer of Chicago Symphony would prioritize highlighting the brass rather than blending it in. By contrast, I thought number two was the most kind of traditionally well-blended of the three, which means to me, Haitink. I mean, that's what all of his recordings have said to me, and that also tracks with the general kind of blend that's, and there's no one really forward in that recording. It's just a general kind of well-blended sound, and that also feels like what I hear of Concertgebouw generally. And then in the last had the characteristics of what you had described to me as Gergiev. I mean, frankly, the ensemble was not good in a lot of that. Like, the beginning and the end of the excerpt were not together, like, really at all. And as that went on, I was thinking, like, well, what would it feel like to watch Gergiev conduct the end of Shosti 5 with his toothpick? And, like, that might be it, actually. Again, I don't know whether I was just reinforcing my own expectations as the excerpts went on, but that was the gut check kind of response that I had to the three.
I think that we should each stick with our guns and see what happens. So yeah, I'm going to go Gergiev.
This game is hard.
It's very hard, yeah.
I know I'm going to feel like an idiot in like T-minus 10 seconds. So.
Well, didn't everybody feel like an idiot? I think that we sounded smart along
the
way.
We're good at that.
Okay, so I'm going to go Gergiev, Haitink, Schulte.
And I go Schulte, Haitink, Gergiev.
All right, Kencho, tell us what it is.
All right, so... Tiffany has one correct.
Lol. Is it the middle one?
Will, not so much. So it's actually really interesting because when I put these excerpts together, I was like, this should be clear. And then I was playing the game with myself, even though I knew which ones there were. And I'm like, this is actually really, really difficult. So
yeah.
I will give it to you. So the first one was, in fact, Schulte. And it was with the Vienna Philharmonic.
So
it was a little bit of a little bit of a bait and switch there. The second one was actually Gergiev with Marinsky, which I think is actually the most surprising thing of this when I was putting together, because it's actually the most normie
right
standard,
now.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Right?
The most blended.
So that kind of goes against our expectations.
Yeah, sure.
And then exactly what Tiffany said about the Concertgebouw recording, the third one, you would expect Haitink and Concertgebouw to be like pristine, yet... Mm-hmm.
The third one is
not so much, but you know, it's the contrast between the three are just like nuts. And that's one of those things where you kind of wonder, like what Will said, is it the conductor or is it the engineer,
or the orchestra
and the orchestra? Yeah. Right. Yeah. I mean, it's a real
combination. 100 people on stage.
Yeah.
I think the conductor ones are the most difficult. I think when Will brought the first time we played this game, we did Brahms 4 or something. And it was, I think Tiffany and I struggled with that as well. So it's not
easy, but it's fun. Yeah. This is a good, game.
It is fun.
All right, that wraps up our prelude segment for this week. But before we wrap up, we'd like to remind our listeners that we do periodic listener-generated Name That Tune rounds, so we invite you to try and stump us. Check our show notes where you'll find a link to the form where you can upload a 30-second clip of an unidentified piece of classical music for us to try to identify. And with that, we move on to our first topic. Tiffany, what do you have for us?
Okay, listeners, it's time to relearn your alphabet, because A is for oboe. A is for Oboe is a children's book released just this past week. Its authors are Lara Auerbach, a composer and classical pianist, and renowned poet Marilyn Nelson. And the book is a collection of poems that create a rich portrait of the orchestra from A to Z, with kind of a musical twist or an orchestral twist. For example, as the title implies, A is not for, say, allegro, but rather for the first note that you hear as you take your seat in the concert hall, played by the, quote, headstrong oboe. B is for the bassoon, the, quote, orchestra's jester complaining impatiently through his nose. And C is for the conductor, like the captain on the bridge of a great ship navigating the composer's musical charts. Onward, the text goes, soaring in reverie, making thought-provoking observations while not taking itself too seriously, and illuminating lots of various details that flow together to create the experience of playing or listening to orchestral music. We at the Gabfest have enjoyed the recent additions to children's literature that explores the world of classical music, so this is a worthy addition to our library. What'd you guys think?
I found this book very confusing.
What, you don't think A is for oboe?
I think that the title really sets it up well in terms of like what the expectations are.
Yes.
What confused me is like, who is this book for?
Yeah.
So the first thing that I'm going to mention is the fact that the poetry, you know, these are short poems. They're usually, you know, I would say a maximum of 10 lines, like you would find in a normal children's book. But the poems do not rhyme. You think that they are going to rhyme because that's like very typical of children's poetry, but then they don't. So it's like, this is already not a standard issue children's book. Then you've got the fact that like, yeah, okay, A is for oboe, which is not. Then you've got some letters where there's like five things that the letter is for. Like, which ones in particular? I can't remember.
R is for both rest and like frullato.
Is for frullato, which is, and so then like you've got some very abstruse musical terminology in here. And then you've got also like very behind the scenes, like L is for librarian. And it's like, yeah, I mean, librarians deserve, you know, a shout out and everything. But like, if this is a kid's first introduction to like the orchestra, that's sort of weird. So I just don't know who, I don't want to say that this is for nobody. This is for a very particular kind of kid. Like this is for
only the children of professional musicians.
That's exactly right. This is for the brainiac children of professional orchestral players. This is for Tiffany Liu, I guess. I don't know. Is this for Tiffany Liu?
I'm not sure what age I would have dug this.
I don't know.
I went and looked up the age category for this book because I was wondering the same thing.
And?
It's ages 7 to 9.
7 to 9? Mm. Ew.
That's 7. Okay. I think I was, you know, already like reading my own books and stuff, right? And
sure.
So I don't know if I would ever go and read this. Though.
Yeah, this is like a little babyish, I think.
Right, it doesn't hit like it's like awkward at that point to be like Z is
reading
for
A
Z's.
To Z books, yeah.
Well, that's the other thing too, is that like there are letters where like there are multiple words associated, and then like, you know, there's a little bit of like a cop out for some of these letters.
Mm-hmm.
Like Q is just Q.
Giving cop outs.
And like the
break.
Z, and like I feel like, you know, we
could huge cop out.
We
could and also like were, you know, letters where I think they were trying to be clever and it by not choosing a word that began with that letter, but it sends it's just confusing, right? Like X.
Mm-hmm.
In what world are you going to present a music book with X does not have xylophone in it?
Yeah,
but you
seriously.
Know that they said to each other, we are not doing X for xylophone. I don't care what else we do. We're not doing X for xylophone. So we're going to do X for the symbol that you use to make cuts in the music, which is like, what 7 to 9-year-old even knows what a cut is?
Right,
like,
exactly.
They're still learning Dalsenyo at that point.
Yeah, I mean, and like, in terms of the age quality of this, again, like, I like the illustrations. In fact, I think that that's the strongest part of the book.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, who's reading a picture book, like, you know, with their parents at the age of 7? And that's the thing. It's like clearly these authors, they're intending this to be, I guess, read on their own by a 7 to 9-year-old. And I guess that they wanted to make the poetry not so kid-like that it has to rhyme in like a Dr. Seuss manner on every page. But like, I don't know. I think that you're not hitting the mark here with this.
It's almost like this would work better if it wasn't an ABC book. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It could have been like a introduction to the instrument or introduction to the classical music world, right?
Yeah, you wouldn't have caught me dead reading an ABC book at age 7.
Right.
If you want to say that this book was for me, like I was reading chapter books at age 7. I'm sorry. You know?
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So is a professional orchestra musician sitting down to... Maybe this is for... You know who this is for? This is for professional orchestra musician parents who sit down and read to infants who are too young to understand what they're saying. That's who this is for.
Maybe if you have like a 9 or 10 year old who's already, you know, a poetry freak and has gotten past the rhyming stage and, you know, thinks that they're like, you know, if they're pretty precocious and they're into like a more modern poetry, which, you know, I'm sure there are some kids out there, and they're into classical music already. Like I said, I mean, this is not for nobody, but boy, is it not for everybody.
Yeah.
It's a very niche area.
As I was reading, you know, the rhyming thing did occur to me, Will, and it's like, I found myself trying to separate what we might interpret these days as, oh, I don't know, normie approaches to children's literature, and that this might be trying to break that mold in some sort of meaningful way. And so I was assessing this as like, from the standpoint of, is this good poetry? Because these two are both, they have both released professional, like, you know, published collections of poetry, these both of these authors. And I found it weird to perceive some of what I think is meant to be kind of highfalutin approach to poetry through the lens of what would normally be a book for ages 3 to 5, not even 7 and 9, you know. So I totally agree with all of your assessments about that. Did you guys think that there were any pages that were more successful? Because I found a couple.
Yeah, I think that there were a couple. And I would say that, you know, rhyming is not the only poetic device. And there is other wordplay in here that I think is pretty appealing. Like, I could read for you the entire F page. What is an orchestra without a flute? Or several, and at least one piccolo, whose shrill trills lilt, filling the ear with thrills. She's tiny but fierce, a ninja Tinkerbell. There's all of this assonance in there and sort of onomatopoeia. You know, there's some nice things in there.
Slant rhyming and,
yeah, and slant
this kind
rhymes.
Of parallelism, right? What is a real children's book if it doesn't have the same linguistic devices throughout the whole book and not just sort of randomly cropping up on different pages? I mean, that's what makes really memorable children's books the way they are.
There's a little bit of a show-offy sense to this of the poets, wouldn't you say? That, like, they're trying to show...
They're flexing on every page.
They're flexing on every page, and not always successfully. I mean, I actually thought that some of the poetry was lazy and bad.
Yeah.
Oh, I have a question. Did you guys catch the gender-bending glockenspiel?
Oh, my God. Why is there... I mean, I was already wondering. So, okay, so A is for oboe, and oboe is a he. Like, the entire stanza of oboe is he. And then the bassoon is also a he. It's a grandpa blowing through his nose. And the conductor is a she. She. Like, whatever happened to they, like, and all of that, like, language of, like, gender-neutral pronouns? Like, we have drums. And, you know, fortunately, drums are not gendered. But by the time we've made it to glockenspiel, why do we have to bring in gender-bending glockenspiel? And in what world is that the instrument that you would choose to be gender-neutral?
It just seemed really, like, forced.
Forced. So forced.
Very forced. Very forced. I mean, in a way, you know, I appreciate the representation, like, in the positive sense of that word.
Sure,
that
it's there great is, to have a female conductor.
Yeah, it's right. We've got a female conductor. We've got, you know, a lady playing piano wearing a hijab. We've got quite a variety of races and stuff, you know, and people are, like, you know, young and dressed in sort of hip clothes or whatever. It's fine, it's great. But yeah, the gender aspect of this really did throw me for a loop. And why gender these inanimate objects that you could,
why?
I mean, not even they, just it, it's a thing, you know? There's all sorts of, you know, positive representation stuff you could do, but, like, this was very self-conscious and weird.
Yeah, and also, like, the illustrations themselves are also extremely gendered, right? There isn't really anyone that you see that's
gender neutral at all.
Yeah. It's a little bit of an incomplete for this.
One of the reasons that this made me feel like this was for orchestral parents who are reading to kids who are too young to appreciate or understand what they're saying is the number of, like, orchestral inside jokes that gets buried in the language here, right? Like, did any of that pop out to you?
Yes.
For instance, you've already mentioned the music librarian, but, like, that's super insider, you know? Like, who in the world even cares? Not even the music librarian cares about their own representation in a children's book.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah, the librarians, I think, would be much happier if kids knew about like all the instruments, if they knew what a xylophone was, versus that they knew that, like, you know, a librarian takes their care to put the bowings in the. I mean, they mentioned the bowings. Yeah. To put the bowings in the parts.
Like the whole thing about not calling timpani drums.
Oh, so we're doing like orchestral like etiquette as well.
Yeah. Yes, they are. They are. This is very inside baseball. Very inside baseball.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And strange and weird and...
Anyway. Okay. Moderately successful. By the way, Will mentioned the illustrations in the book, which were done by Paul Hopp, who was born in Poland, raised in Germany, resides in Brooklyn, New York, and like does art at a place called the Pencil Factory, which I found very cool. But those are the illustrations. And I do think the illustrations are, you know, appealing. Like as a kid, that is the part that I might have flipped through just to look. And I was not a picture kind of kid, but like I would probably flip through this book to look at the pictures.
Did I also read that Thomas Kwasthoff is the person that they got to do the audio version of this? Because that I actually would listen to.
Yeah.
So maybe we should take a listen to that at some point.
All right. Well, check it out. Mixed reviews here at the GabFest, but you know, again, it's still fun to see children's literature being expanded in ways that feature classical music. So, you know, we'll take this into our libraries. All right, let's go to our second topic, Will.
All right, listeners, it's now time for another installment of the Classical GabFest Concert Club. This time, we've chosen a program by the Frankfurt Radio Symphony, aka the HR Sinfonieorchester, conducted by Alain Altinoglu. The concert took place last month on December 10th, 2021, and featured works by Wagner, Gubaidulina, and Mahler. Let's hear a clip, a bit of the second movement from Mahler's First Symphony. Regular listeners to our podcast will know that I think very highly of the Frankfurt Radio Symphony, but that I mostly suggest albums and concerts of random Baroque bric-a-brac to talk about on our show. So now I've finally come up with a straightforward, normie Overture Concerto Symphony concert. So what did you guys think of it?
I thought it was a cool program. I mean, I was more drawn to the Gubaidulina violin concerto than anything else on the program. Everything else was kind of like, okay, German orchestra performing German music. Cool. You know, like, I don't know. I wasn't particularly that hyped about anything else on the program, but I love this concerto. Did you guys like it?
Not really.
No.
I have a hard time with a lot of Gubaidulina. I have to say, like, you know, maybe it was just after I had read A is for Oboe, but the phrasing and kind of build up of it, and I admit to having skipped over large chunks of it and kind of clicked through to see like, okay, is anything different happening now? But you know how it's really easy these days to kind of write fake poetry by like not capitalizing any of the words and kind of dropping in like single word lines of poetry that like, you know, just that are supposed to draw in some sort of connotation. It reminded me, the listening experience reminded me of reading that kind of poetry.
Oh, interesting.
So I was not able to make sense of it. It may be worthwhile to mention for our listeners. So this is a violin concerto called
Dialogue. Ich und du.
Yeah, I and you. And in the familiar versions of those pronouns. So kind of an intimate version of me and you. Mm-hmm. And like, I'm listening to this being like, can I hear me and you? Is you the violin? Is you me? Is the orchestra they? Are you like what is going on? I don't know. And maybe I just don't have an ear for this. But I have always had, I've been, you know, a little challenged by Gubaidulina's music. I just don't get it. And it's not that I don't find interjections of that compelling in some way, but I don't see the story, and I especially don't see the title.
Oh, well, actually really saw the title in the way that she blends the orchestra's last note to the solo's last note and vice versa. There is this kind of like sound blending that she does really well with orchestration. I also love, there is a moment, I think like 6 minutes in the concerto where it's a sound that I haven't really heard before. The camera is focused only on the harps, but I cannot imagine that sound is only coming from the harps. I think it's got to be like some kind of percussion or harp blend. And I think for me, like Gubadulina's music is all about, especially her orchestral music, is about the instrumentation and the blends of instruments. She kind of combines instruments in a very interesting way. And so I'm always listening out for that. And I thought that this piece had a lot of that.
Yeah, and I don't disagree about that, but like I'm still looking for phrases. Right? Like if music is the use of time as your tapestry, then individual moments of execution, such as the fading of two instruments, cannot, like, for me, sustain a 25-minute concerto.
I agree with both of you. I agree that Gubadulina, her strengths as a composer are, I think, in making individual bits of fabric and finding interesting ways to stitch them together, but that the structure, like, I don't know what the hell is going on with her music ever. Like, you know, it's not a structure that I can usually follow. I, of course, adore the music of Alfred Schnittke. They were contemporaries and very much in dialogue with each other. And, you know, not surprisingly, I like Gubadulina's music most when it sounds like Schnittke, which it does a fair amount of the time. But I find his structures much, much more compelling. Mm-hmm. And like, you know, he's responding to the received tradition more so in writing symphonies and concertos and stuff like that. This piece, you know, like I found a lot of individual things to like. And on the whole, I'm sitting at the end like, well, what did I just hear? You know? So, and also, by the way, two sets of timpani in this orchestration. No, I'm sorry. That is overkill. This piece did not need two separate sets of timpani. Kencho, the moment that you pointed out that thing with the harps, that also really stuck out to me. That was so cool. Yeah, yeah.
Do you know? I mean, I want to see the score because it's such a weird sound.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what was going on there. I really don't. This piece, I'll mention, is from 2018. It's her third violin concerto, so it's a pretty recent piece of music. Mm-hmm. And what did you guys think of the violin soloist, though?
I like her.
Yeah.
She owned this piece.
Yeah, I mean, it was like really confident. No, it was like, it was a no frills, but like kind of strong presentation, which I did appreciate.
I should mention her name is Baiba Skride. She is a Latvian violinist who won the 2001... Queen Elizabeth, I think. I had never heard of her before, but apparently she's like a pretty big, important violinist.
She did a great job.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Did you want to mention her encore at all?
Did want to mention her encore. Yeah, she played this piece by Johann Westhoff, a pre-Bach violin composer, sort of a contemporary of Bieber. And I was so transfixed by this. Did you guys know this encore?
Never heard of it.
I had never heard it. It sounded so much like the violin solo from Fratres by Arvo Pärt.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
I don't know. I'm going to secretly slip this into the classical mixtape playlist because it's just a little 2-minute thing. It is amazing. I just was transfixed is the only word I can say.
I'm not sure that I had as positive a reaction. I mean, I'm not trying to rain on your parade. You may find, I mean, I don't, contrary to the impression that you will get after hearing me in this segment, I'm not this negative about like concerts in general. And this is this kind of music criticism, we'll say, that I actually really enjoy doing. So despite everything negative that I'm saying, I enjoyed the experience of watching and thinking critically and hearing good, well-made music. Like that is something that must be said. I will always rather see this concert than not see this concert. Okay. So let me preface my comment with that. That said, I wasn't impressed by this choice of repertoire or the quality of the piece. I mean, it's fine, you know, for where it came from. It's pretty. kind of minimalist chord changey thing, but not particularly difficult, not particularly interesting. Maybe what I should be thinking more of is the lesson that Sunny brought to us when she recommended a couple of weeks ago on our mixtape that spectralism piece, which is that like you kind of have to like sink into the experience of just like being in individual moments without looking for something that, you know, is a goal or something to go towards or come away from. That's obviously the wrong mentality to go into listening to either the Goodbye Delina or this encore. But I did find myself wanting for like a little bit of flesh. I don't know. This piece just wasn't challenging enough for me to like be presented as an impressive encore.
Well, to me, the encore paired maybe more than with the Goodbye Delina with the Wagner Prelude to Parsifal. Hmm. You know, these are both pieces that are like all about the wash, sure. You know, and the textural chord changes and stuff. So what'd you guys think of the Wagner? Let's just check that one off the list first before we get to Mahler, which is sort of the big daddy here. Do you like this piece?
I love it.
Oh, yeah. I like it.
You both like it. Okay. And this performance?
It left me cold.
Really?
I thought it was just kind of matter of fact. The notes go by.
Yeah, I had the same kind of impression.
I was struck by the quality of sound in the opening seconds. I mean, which is like, that's the stunning part of this piece. It's like just like hearing that timbre. But like as the piece goes on and you realize, okay, this is what you get for the duration of the piece. It's like, what do you want in those notes that transform? Do you want this sort of like tapestry that's kind of effortlessly shifting colors throughout the entire thing? Or do you want something that has some passion inside it? And I was not feeling legato or connection or like that notes had direction or that they had tension and release, like none of that. And, you know, now I'm seeing that my comments about the Goodbye Delina and the encore are kind of similar in this regard, that it's like I'm looking for musical striving and goals and desire.
See, that's so interesting because I quite liked this, and I thought that it had a beautiful sense of color. And then I thought that what Altinoglu was able to do was give it a very elegant shape and phrasing without pushing too much or, you know, going, I guess, for that overwhelming Wagnerian desire that we often think of. And I think that Parsifal is an outlier in Wagner's output in that regard.
The whole opera or just this?
Oh, the opera, for sure. I mean, you know, by this point, I mean, you know, Parsifal, I mean, people say all these crazy things about it, but I mean, truly, it is like a meditative Buddhist influence, and quite literally, Buddhism via Schopenhauer influenced 6-hour-long meditation on God knows what. And the prelude here, which has such intricate tapestry, like if you look at the score and look at like the layers of rhythm that are going on in this piece, like it is almost Ligeti-like in terms of, you know, the mathematical way that that it's written. But yeah, I thought that this was played beautifully. I thought that it was shaped very gorgeously. Kensho, you didn't go along with it, though.
You know, it's so quiet and lovely and lyrical and all this for a while. And then we finally get this, like, big moment, let's say, with the cymbals and everything. And I feel like it just happened without much in consideration for, like, the overall arc. So I'm disagreeing with you a little bit in terms of the phrasing or the arc or the shape.
Well, no, I mean, I think we're all hearing the same thing, but we're all coming away with different opinions of whether that thing was the right thing to do with this piece or not. And like, you know, I mean, that was exactly the point at which I decided, okay, I guess we're not going to make anything special, because like, if you start off something with that degree of Zen chillness, then maybe I might expect, especially in Wagner, I mean, we're not in Ligeti territory, you know, we're in Wagner territory. So like, there's going to be a moment that you want and yearn for, I think. You know, I think that's that, as much as Wagner tries and enters that like kind of Zen meditation space, like that's just not who he is, I think. So like, when you get to the juice moment and it kind of doesn't happen, then it's like, okay, well, what were we doing here all along? Did you just phone this in?
Thank you.
Well, now I'm so curious to know what we're going to say about the performance of Mahler's First Symphony. Where did you guys come down on this?
It's kind of the same. I don't know. I have to admit that I did not listen to every single note of this performance. I kind of skipped around. But maybe perhaps my favorite moment in the whole symphony is after the first outburst of the last movement, where we have this super, super, super quiet, lovely lyrical section. Again, it was maybe using Tiffany's terminology, it just felt cold to me. I don't know. It didn't speak to me so much. Also, we haven't really talked about Altinoglu yet, but the only thing I can notice is that he does like duck face all the time when he's conducting. It's a little bit distracting for me, at least. But that's just like a conductor pet peeve, I guess.
I thought his conducting was great, quite honestly. Like, I find him rhythmic and elegant, not over the top, in control, always ahead of the orchestra. I personally thought his conducting was great. I loved this Mahler one. You know, I mean, I'm not the biggest Mahler person in the world, but I watched this concert twice all the way through, and it held my attention from start to finish. You know, I just thought that the tempi were really good. I thought the orchestra was allowed to play. And I thought that Mahler really spoke out. I thought the pacing was great. I mean, yeah, in the last movement, there's all of these very operatic interludes, like almost Verdian, you know? And to me, those spoke. I guess not to you guys. Interesting. Tiffany, what did you think?
Yeah, I'm going to come down more with Kensho on this one as well. I mean, and this jives with what I thought of the rest of the concert, which is that it was good and a little cold. I love Mahler 1. It is one of my top 5 symphonies. Mm-hmm. I cannot explain my love for it. I feel a little juvenile when I admit it, but I love this symphony. And I do subscribe to, like, I know that this is a little controversial, but I like the Bernstein recordings. I think they're awesome.
I think they're awesome too.
But a lot of what turns people off from Mahler is like this kind of saturin quality of like overdoing everything, right? Like, mm-hmm. like putting lipstick on the pig kind of thing. And I can see that to people who felt like that, the smaller might be more compelling just because it is just transparent. But like, I don't think Mahler is transparent at all, even in his first symphony, which is, you know, easily the most kind of conservative of the 9. For me, in this recording, that yielded both strengths and weaknesses, but more weaknesses for me than strengths. And for me, mainly in the choice of tempi were all too fast, especially the beginning of the 4th movement. I was like, what are we doing? Like, there is about 1,000 notes in here. We were supposed to hear a struggling, but like not just like getting past it, which is what it felt like. You know, here's this like apocalyptic kind of thunderstorm stuff. And it was like, it all just blew by. I thought, you know, the second movement, there's places where, like, it should definitely feel hesitation with, like, just, you know, it's like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, you know, just like a little bit of that. And it was nowhere there. Like, I know that some people would call that sentimental, but I love it in Mahler. I love it. One place where I thought that it did work to the benefit was the tempo in the first movement when he reached, like, kind of the theme. He was able to achieve that with perfect ease. And that was because the rest of the tempo had already been kind of fast-ish. So like getting and settling into the tempo that feels right was super close, but it was effective because often I think conductors do have trouble getting to that was easy and it felt easy. Sometimes you have trouble achieving that sense there because it's been so like laboriously built up over the course of, you know, 8 octave A's for a billion years. So there were places where it's like, okay, you achieve that movement. But again, the same way as in the opening of the concert, where it's like, if you get to the money moment and it happens and it just goes by, like, did you really mean for that to happen? Or were you just, did you just set up the circumstances in the beginning that allowed you to be closer to that when you eventually got there? So I did find myself questioning the motivations of the shaping as the concert went on, because I was bored, frankly.
I don't think I was bored, but I would say that it's obviously a very, very good orchestra with a very good conductor. So that's already baseline. So you can enjoy it, like what Tiffany was saying earlier. But if you're going to devote an hour of your time to listen to Mahler 1, you want to come away with even one moment where you're like, wow. And I don't think I got that in this performance. And maybe that's because it's not live. And to me, like, it's always about being in the room to hear this. And maybe that experience would have been different if I were in the hall. So, yeah.
Well,
sorry, Will.
Well, no, but I mean, like, I'm not sure that I, you know, we have all this idea of like investing time and like spending and like having it be like return on investment. I don't want every performance that I hear of Mahler 1 to be like the performance. You know, I need to have the spectrum of expectations set. So like here, this goes is going to go in my spectrum of like, okay, from, you know, if I'm going to do like the Top Gear, you know, ranking of like all the times around the lap. That's a very obscure reference that neither of you is going to get. But I'm going to slot this in like, you know, maybe at the 30 or 40th percentile. In terms of like satisfaction of watching it, but it's still like on the board, and I still am glad that you I frankly enjoyed this concert more than a lot of the other concert clubs that we've done, just because I know the repertoire real well, and that by itself provides some gratification, because I am reassessing my spectrum and reordering my kind of board of knowledge. You know, and that feels good, like that feels like professional work to me, which frankly a lot of what I do does not. So
well, in closing up this segment, I will just reiterate my opinion that this concert was freaking fantastic. And I'm happy that I brought it, you know, for all the reasons that Tiffany said. Like, it gave us a lot of food for discussion. Mm-hmm. And it's good to have fruitful disagreement talking about these things. But truly, I think what needs to happen now is that our listeners need to give this concert a watch. It's in individual videos, and we'll link them in our show notes. And, you know, you got to say one thing for the Frankfurt Radio Symphony, which is that they cut out the applause at the beginning of their videos. It just goes right into
this orchestra has the best internet presence of any group.
Exactly.
There's not even a competition.
Right.
This orchestra has killed it so hard.
I agree. So. I agree entirely. So listeners, take advantage of the fact that this orchestra has done such phenomenal work in putting their stuff online, and give this a listen. I mean, truly, we need some listener responses from this segment. All right. But we'll end it there, and we'll have Kensho take us into our third topic here.
Over the last few months, we've been following a developing story about the Chamber Music Society of Lincoln Center in New York. Back in October, friend of the show Zachary Wolf of the New York Times called out the Chamber Music Society on, quote, a conservatism extreme even by classical music's low standards. Wolf points out that of the more than 100 works presented by the organization this season, only 2 are by living composers. A few weeks later, the artistic directors of the Chamber Music Society, Wu Han and David Finkel, responded to the criticism and shared their views on programming with an interview with Javier Hernandez, again with The Times. And finally, in late December, the CMS announced a 5-year contract extension for Han and Finkel, to which Wolf responded by tweeting, "Rehire the same leaders, you'll get the same results." So this is a very pared-down summary of what's been going on here. We can delve deep into this really kind of bizarre interview that was done in the Times in response to the criticism that Zach levied against the CMS. So, yeah, what are your initial thoughts about all this?
Well, you mentioned that Zach Wolf has been on our podcast. He's a friend of the show, and he's a friend of mine. And I often agree with him. I don't always agree with him, but I do agree with him in this sense. What I would note from his original article was he said, this is not about imposing some kind of a quota of new music on an organization. But if we take a holistic view and you're presenting a season with over 100 works and only 2 of them are written by living composers, and one of them is by George Crumb and it was written 50 years ago, and the other is by Wynton Marsalis, who is like, you know, one of the other artistic directors at Lincoln Center, I think that that is laziness and kind of a dereliction of duty on the part of these people. Because look, if this were a 4-concert chamber series at some like private art gallery in like an obscure small like little house museum, fine, go with God, play your Schubert, play your Beethoven, do what you want to do. But this is like the chamber music equivalent of the New York Philharmonic, of the Metropolitan Opera. This is like the major public face of chamber music in New York City. And I think that you have to represent the state of the art to a greater extent. Now, I can take a devil's advocate version of this, but maybe we'll get to that in a second. I don't know. What, Tiffany, what did you make of this?
I'm with you on that, Will. I mean, it's very well to say with your one concert that imposing a quota on that is like a little bit ridiculous, right? You only have 3 concerts to do. Like, fine, if you're not going to try and uphold industry standards. But when you essentially are the industry and you're presenting, what, 100-plus concerts a year, be aware that you have a statistic. Not that you are small enough and cottage enough and niche enough to kind of say the statistics don't apply to me, or that I don't need to kind of do my part in upholding them. It's like saying, you know, how we're talking about how corporations and global warming are responsible. Hmm. It's like that, rather than, you know, having individuals be the choice. And I find a lot of the doubling down on this attitude really unattractive, more unattractive, frankly, than the original programming itself. Because, you know, fine if people call you out on your conservatism, and then maybe you say, well, try and do better. But they didn't even remotely try and do that. In fact, this quote is really rather cringeworthy and does not represent our field well, this idea of, let me just read the quote in the New York Times interview where David Finkel says, I feel very sorry for the point of view that, what's he referencing? He's referencing the
quote that I read, actually, the fact that conservatism extreme, even by classical music's low standard, I think is what he was responding to.
Yeah, so Finkel says, I feel very sorry for the idea that this sort of conservatism in programming is so extreme and locks out a vital part of the diversity of the classical music field because, quote, the person is missing so much opportunity for enjoyment. I mean, there is more variety and diversity in a single string quartet of Haydn than you can find in about 100 works of other composers. Our repertoire spans 500 years of music. You know how much variety there is in that 500 years? And it's like, you are missing the point entirely? Yeah, that's all I've got to say about that. Like, you are missing the point entirely.
That's just, like, wrong. Like, there's not, Haydn is great. I love Haydn. There is a lot of variety and invention in Haydn's music, but there is not more
that's not what we're talking about, buddy.
one string quartet than there is in, like, the works of 100 other composers. Second of all, you say that your repertoire has 500 years of music. Well, I don't know. Where's the last 100 years? And is he really doing, are they really doing, like, Middle Ages?
Yeah, he's definitely doing Renaissance madrigals.
Are they really doing Josquin and, like, you know, Guillaume Dufay? I don't think so, buddy. But then there was an even stranger quote. Kencho, maybe you want to talk about this, about when he compared like this idea of, I don't know. I don't really know what he was referring to, but maybe he was talking about like imposing a quota or an expectation of having some kind of more contemporary music as like similar to Soviet Russia or communist China.
Yeah, in response to the question, this was the question. The question was, how did the pandemic change you and your organization? Which was that was the question. And the response from David Finkel was, in Soviet Russia, in communist China, people were literally prevented from hearing music, not by a disease, but by governmental laws and censorship. It's the way that I, as a privileged American, can feel an even deeper kinship with people having lived in Germany during the 1930s or the 40s and 50s in China, and certainly the Soviet Union under Joseph Stalin.
It's an unfortunate choice of metaphor, but like, I don't take issue with this sentiment, actually. I mean, it's weird that he chose to draw in like political regimes and like that automatically kind of imposes a sort of structure on that response that I don't think he meant to happen. Mm-hmm. But what he's saying is that he has been in situations before where access to the arts has been prevented by entities beyond your control. And so to have access to that again has become, by consequence, more meaningful. I think that's all he was trying to say here.
And I wish that he had said that, but really what the implication of what he said,
yeah.
Let's be honest, like, okay, so entities beyond his control are keeping music from the ears of listeners, but like, guess what, buddy? You're the one who's in charge of this. Like, if you want to talk about 1930s Germany, where, you know, the regime was suppressing music by, you know what, anti-artists, right? That was like too far avant-garde by, you know, a certain element of society that they didn't want to, or a certain style of music that they didn't want to hear. It's like, okay, well, you're kind of the one that's doing that.
No, but
here,
he's not addressing style of music at all in this question, like literally at all. The question is, how did the pandemic change?
I know that
you?
That's not what he's addressing, but that is, to me, what is being implied. You know, I can't help but have, but hear that implication because of the context of this interview.
Mm-hmm. Another quote that I had that I want to read is this idea that Finkel says that we never want to force people to listen to music that they don't want to listen to because we think it's good for them. And that's a reason why they don't program more adventurously. And that kind of points to, again, I'm not privy to the dynamic of how the listenership or the audience that regularly comes to these concerts and how conservative they are. I would imagine that they're quite conservative, but how, when you're programming a season and stuff like that, well, I mean, do you have to answer to that conservatism, and how do you, is that, I just feel odd hearing that. And I don't think anybody's forcing anybody to listen to anything, you know?
I'll say that I agree in a sense with the attitude that nobody should be forced to listen to something that they don't want to. What my feeling about programming is that you have to work very diligently to make intelligent pairings of contemporary music with standard repertoire. And that if you do it right, you will open a door for your audience that they might not have known existed. So that's why I said my very first reaction to this was that their programming is lazy and lacks diligence. Because, yeah, I agree. Don't put a Haydn symphony and an Elliot Carter, quartet, or Haydn quartet and an Elliot Carter quartet on the same program. Maybe one person in your audience is going to appreciate that and like it, but a lot of them are not going to. Okay, so fine. So let's find pairings that work well together. I mean, start with, say, the Ravel violin sonata and put friend of the show Damien Jeter's quartet Neo Soul. There's an interesting pairing that would certainly open up doors to the way that people listen. Music that interacts with jazz or contemporary African-American vernacular styles. There you go. There's a cool pairing. Think about all the other people who've been on our show. Jennifer Higdon has a sextet that you could pair with Copland, you know, something like that. That would be an interesting pairing. I think that if you take people where they are and then take them an extra step, that is good intentional programming that can fulfill this goal of opening people's ears. So that's the way that I think about it. I agree with them that you should not just put a bunch of random contemporary music on your programming just to put it on there, just to, you know, tick a box and fulfill a quota and to say, oh, well, we do this, that, and the other. It's got to be more than that.
But that quote to me points to the fact that they think of it as that, that there's no middle ground. It's either just we do continue what we're doing, and then, oh, now we're being forced to do only Elliot Carter or whatever, you know, Jennifer Higdon or whatever. And obviously that's not what the article is pointing out to. And the other thing that we haven't mentioned is that what's particularly frustrating about this is that a chamber music society like this is way more flexible and adaptable in terms of their programming or even where they perform than, let's say, a symphony orchestra like we just listened to in Frankfurt, right? Mm-hmm. Right? So yeah, there is just so much more possibility, so much more, I mean, there's so much resource there as well. They're in freaking Lincoln Center, of course. Like there's endless possibilities as to how they can kind of chart the course for this organization now for the next 5 years as well.
Right. And I think that this sort of the claim that they fall back on is don't fix what ain't broken. You know, I mean, they say that they fill their halls and that their, you know, audience members really like what they do. And so that they're serving some vital public good. But, you know, there's more than one way to skin a cat here. And I think that they could easily fill their halls with more interesting, adventurous and intentional programming as well.
All right. Well, I just wanted to close with a tweet that was posted in response to Zach Wolf's thing. The quote is, does anyone go to Lincoln Center to hear anything fresh, though?
Did you see the first comment underneath this? Because I think the comment is just good.
Oh, which?
So the comment is, yeah, someone's got to keep on going like business as usual, right? Sure, fresh is good, but when vacuum-sealed refrigeration has made unbelievable strides locking in all the nutrition, why not just defrost in a beautiful concert hall?
Well, if we're all reading tweets, I'll say this this other tweet, which I thought was actually pretty good. There is a difference between museums and mausoleums. The prior have wide-ranging collections, including contemporary works. The new helps us understand the old. Many music institutions are becoming mausoleums of work created in a 150-year span. It's a disservice to the art.
Yeah, I mean, the mindset that helps me think about questions like this that is most helpful is like thinking of it from the perspective of a museum. And like museums are still highly relevant. I mean, I lived in DC for a while, and like that's the culture. You go to a lot of museums, and it's fun to see museums who manage to approach the work of historical preservation in a way that feels vital and relevant. And there's definitely a way to do that and like not feel like, oh, we're just abandoning old things for newfangled, fancy, stupid things, you know, which is, it's not so black and white or zero sum.
Hear, hear. All right. Well, that closes this discussion, but hopefully in the next 5 years, we see more than just two pieces on a season with living composers. On to our classical mixtape, Tiffany.
In our classical mixtape, we each recommend some music that's caught our ear this week to share with our listeners. So Will, what do you have this week?
Well, okay, out of respect to Lara Auerbach, who I think is actually a pretty good composer, and I knew that I was not going to be saying very complimentary things about her book of children's poetry, I did want to put a piece on our mixtape by her that I think is really pretty cool. It's called Dreams and Whispers of Poseidon. It's a tone poem for orchestra, and it is distinguished by the fact that it includes both a theremin and a musical saw. So right up my alley, very much so.
Thank you for what will hopefully be a redeeming, I guess, addition to the mixtape. Kensho, what do you have for us?
I am bringing another piece of Sofia Gubaidulina for this classical mixtape. I thought I would bring some non-orchestral music here. This is a piece for violin and piano called Dancer on a Tightrope, played by Gidon Kramer and Vadim Sakharov.
Well, and to round out our mixtape for the day, I guess I have something related to nothing. This is Prokofiev's Symphonia Concertante, performed by Rostropovich and Ozawa with London Symphony. I mean, I love Prokofiev, and if you are already a Prokofiev lover but don't know this piece, it's worth digging into, because I do think that this piece kind of, it's not center stage because it's kind of weird, like it's, you know, unconventional movement structure and just like a little bit strange. It doesn't have the songfulness of like, say, Romeo and Juliet, but it has so many of the same colors that you will recognize, and it does have this kind of soaring lyricism that I don't know why it surprised me when I was listening to it for the first time this past week, but it's a cool piece, and as a fan of Prokofiev, I am really into it.
Thank you.
You'll find the links to all these and to our full classical mixtape playlist in the show notes.
And with that, it's time to wrap up this episode of the Classical Gabfest. I'm William White, and on behalf of Tiffany Liu and Kensho Watanabe, I'd like to thank you so much for listening and to encourage you to subscribe and rate us on your podcast app that now includes Spotify. They have ratings now, so give us a rating on Spotify, please. We'd also love your help spreading the word about the show on social media, where you can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can reach us at classicalgabfest@gmail.com, and we'd love to hear from you. Until next time, happy listening, and we'll be with you next week.